Another of the passages commonly cited by skeptics of the deity of Christ and the doctrine of the Trinity is John chapter 1, verse 18, which says, "No one has seen God at any time." The argument goes that since John says God has not been seen, but Jesus was seen by lots of people, he therefore cannot be God. Pretty straightforward. Of course, this verse has been a part of John's gospel since it was first written down nearly 2 millennia ago. And throughout the history of the church, even going back to the earliest days of its existence, esteemed Christians have not had any problem maintaining their confession that Jesus is truly God, in full recognition of this verse. For as much as groups like Muslims, Jehovah's Witnesses, and other Unitarians point to John chapter 1 verse 18 as supposed refutation of the Trinitarian position, these assertions do not explain why well-read Christians have maintained a Trinitarian confession down through the ages. So, how can this be? If John 1:18 is really a refutation of any claim to divinity on Jesus' part, how has the Christian faith consistently understood this verse while confessing Christ to be truly God? In order to answer this question, as well as the question of what John is talking about in this verse, we need to look at it in context. John chapter 1 verse 18 does not exist as a single verse in pure isolation. Rather, this verse, and every other verse in the Bible, is part of a greater narrative that the author has written. In order to properly understand John's words here, we have to consider the narrative in which he has placed this statement. First, is it in fact true that God has never been seen? Many Old Testament passages speak to this. In Amos chapter 9 verse 1, the prophet says, "I saw the Lord standing beside the altar." In 1 Kings chapter 22 verse 19, the prophet Micaiah says, "Therefore, hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne." Famously, in Exodus chapter 33 verse 11, "Thus the Lord used to speak to Moses face to face, just as a man speaks to his friend." These are just a few examples. Two passages to draw attention to specifically are Isaiah chapter 6 and Genesis chapter 18. Isaiah chapter 6 states, quote, "In the year of King Uzziah's death, I saw the Lord sitting on a throne, lofty and exalted, with the train of his robe filling the temple. For my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts." This passage is particularly of interest because John cites it in chapter 12, verse 41, wherein he states that Isaiah saw the glory of Jesus and spoke of Jesus in his ministry. Therefore, two conclusions we can draw from this are: one, John recognized that God had, in fact, been seen before, and two, he believed that the God who was seen, at least in Isaiah's case, was the pre-incarnate Son. The other passage of interest to us now, Genesis chapter 18, is replete with testimony that Abraham did not just see God, but he had very intimate fellowship with him. Abraham washed God's feet. He fed God a meal. He sat with God under the oaks of Mamre. And he had a prolonged face-to-face conversation with God, wherein he pleaded for Sodom and Gomorrah. Genesis chapter 18 tells us that not only did God appear to Abraham, but he appeared to him in something akin to a physical human body, along with the two angels with him. John also makes reference to this portion of scripture in chapter 8 of his gospel, where he quotes Jesus in passionate argument with some Pharisees as saying, quote, "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." Further, he quotes Jesus earlier in this chapter as making reference to the fact that Abraham had a real opportunity to kill him. Quote, "They answered and said to him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, if you are Abraham's children, do the deeds of Abraham. But as it is, you are seeking to kill me, a man who has told you the truth, which I heard from God. This Abraham did not do." Notice the charge Jesus levels at the crowd. Quote, "You are seeking to kill me. If you are really Abraham's descendants, you should be treating me the same way Abraham did. Abraham did not try to do this." Jesus' whole point is that the crowd is really trying to kill him, and he contrasts their behavior with Abraham. The force of his condemnation, though, is that Abraham had, if he wanted to, the same kind of real opportunity to kill Jesus. But how can this be? Jesus lived somewhere between 1500 and 2000 years after Abraham. Even the Jewish crowd was bewildered by Jesus' claim. Quote, "You are not yet 50 years old and you have seen Abraham?" It is to this question that Jesus would famously say, "Before Abraham was, I am," in verse 58. His point through this dialogue is that he is the God that Abraham interacted with in Genesis chapter 18. Again, this affirms the two points we have previously concluded about John. One, he recognized God had in fact been seen before. And two, he believed that the God who was seen was the pre-incarnate Son. But if this is true, then why would John say, quote, "No man has seen God at any time"? Obviously, the answer to this cannot be the, quote, plain reading that Muslims, Jehovah's Witnesses, and other Unitarians assert this verse means, because that would put John in contradiction both with the Old Testament and with himself later in his gospel. We've looked at some of the greater contexts of John's statement. Now, to properly understand him in verse 18, we have to look specifically at the context of chapter 1. Verse 18 is the bookend to what is known as John's prologue, the introductory statement that begins his gospel. This means that verse 18 is part of a single statement that proceeds back to the very first verse. The first verse of John's gospel reads, quote, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." I have done a whole video about how to properly interpret John chapter 1, verse 1, so I will direct you there for detailed explanation. For purposes of this video, note how John is using the word God in this verse. In the second clause, John says, quote, "God" as a personal reference. We know this because, one, in the Greek, God is articular. In other words, it's accompanied by the word the. And two, God is in opposition to the Word. John has not yet told us who either God or the Word is. So let's not assume to know for the time being. Moving into the third clause, John again makes reference to God, but this time it is not a personal reference. It is a qualitative reference. We know this here because the word God is an anarthrous predicate nominative for the Word, connected by a linking verb, was. What John is saying in the third clause is that the Word was, by his nature, God. To put it another way, the Word was truly divine, or the Word was qualitatively God. The important thing to recognize with respect to verse 18 is that John has set a precedent in verse 1 of using the word God of more than one figure. The quote-unquote God of clause 2, whoever that is, and the Word in clause 3. John states later in verse 14 that, quote, "the Word became flesh and dwelt among us." So we know from this verse that the Word John is speaking of is the pre-incarnate Christ, who would later become the man, Jesus. But this still leaves the question, who is the quote-unquote God in the second clause of verse 1? This brings us to verse 18 proper. No one has seen God at any time. The only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father, he has explained him. Obviously, we've noted that God was seen many times in the Old Testament. So what is John saying? Look closely at the rest of the verse. The only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father. We have been introduced to a new character, the Father. John also states that, quote, "the only begotten God is in the bosom or in the intimate fellowship of the Father." This means that the Father must also be truly divine, truly God. Now we know that the quote-unquote God of clause 2 of verse 1 is the person of the Father, contrasted with the Word, the person of the Son. But this begs another question. If John has used the word God in reference to both the Father and the Son thus far, who is he referring to when he says no one has seen God? Is he saying no one has seen the Father, or is he saying no one has seen the Son? John is obviously not saying the latter because he has already stated in verse 14, quote, the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory. Glory is of the only begotten from the Father. Therefore, John is saying that no one has seen the Father. But look at what else he says. Quote, the only begotten God who is in the bosom of the Father, he has explained him. Compare this with verse 14. The only begotten God is the Word, the Son, Jesus. Look at what John says he did for the Father, because no one has seen him. The Word has explained the Father, or made him known. The Word can do this because he is God, just as the Father is. John's point in this verse is this. God was in fact seen many times in the Old Testament. But the person of God who was seen was not the Father, as many of his Jewish readers would have assumed. Rather, the God who was seen by Abraham, Moses, Isaiah, and all the rest was the pre-incarnate Son, Jesus, before he came as a man. He is the one who has been revealing himself to God's people all this time. Yet, he is the same one that they have crucified because they did not believe his testimony. Rather than being a refutation of Christ's deity, John chapter 1 verse 18 is actually one of the most powerful assertions that Jesus is, in fact, truly God, just as the Father is. For more information on the deity of Christ and the doctrine of the Trinity, please see this playlist on my channel, or view the corresponding lectures from my Fundamentals of the Christian Faith class.